So humble yourself and see what God will do. Humble yourself before your Lord and King. Give him your heart, offer your everything. There's no limit on the love he has for you. So humble yourself and see what God will do. Humble yourself and let him have his way. Love his word and his will obey. For his eyes are on the one whose heart is true. So humble yourself and see what God will do. Amen. Amen. This morning, Sister Cheryl was playing All Heaven Declares, so I think we should sing that. Amen. Amen. All heaven declares the glory of the risen Lord. Who can compare with the beauty of the Lord? Forever he will be the Lamb upon the throne. I'll gladly bend my knees to worship you alone. I will proclaim the glory of the risen Lamb, who once was slain to reconcile man to God. Forever you will be the Lamb upon the throne. I'll gladly bend my knees to worship you alone. All heaven declares the glory of the risen Lord. Who can compare with the beauty of the Lord? Forever he will be the Lamb upon the throne. I'll gladly bend my knees to worship you alone. I will proclaim the glory of the risen Lamb, who once was slain to reconcile man to God. Forever you will be the Lamb upon the throne. I'll gladly bend my knees to worship you alone. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Yes, Brother Mike, if you'll just open in a word of prayer. Amen. 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 You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Come and go with me. Amen. Come and go with me to my Father's house, to my Father's house, to my Father's house. Come and go with me to my Father's house, where there's peace, sweet peace. Jesus will be there in my Father's house, in my Father's house, in my Father's house. Jesus will be there in my Father's house, where there's peace, sweet peace. There'll be no sorrow there in my Father's house, in my Father's house, in my Father's house. There'll be no sorrow there in my Father's house. There'll be joy, real joy. So come and go with me to my Father's house, to my Father's house, to my Father's house. Come and go with me to my Father's house, where there's peace, sweet peace. Amen. Consciousness be there in my Father's house, in my Father's house, in my Father's house. Jesus will be there in my Father's house, where there's peace, sweet peace. There'll be no sorrow there in my Father's house, in my Father's house, in my Father's house. There'll be no sorrow there in my Father's house. There'll be joy, real joy. Amen. Are you sad this morning? Are you? There'll be no sorrow there in my Father's house, in my Father's house, in my Father's house. There'll be no sorrow there in my Father's house. There'll be joy, real joy. So come and go with me to my Father's house, to my Father's house, to my Father's house. Come and go with me to my Father's house, where there's peace, sweet peace. Amen. Amen. You know, that's what they used to do in the Old Testament. You say, oh, what did they do in the Old Testament? They're going into battle. They'd have the singers go first.
That's right.
The singers would say, oh, praise the Lord, it's Sunday again. We're going to get the victory. No. Come and go with me. Jesus is going to be there.
Amen.
He'll be there if you expect him. And if you have sorrow and pain and worry, and we all have worry. Amen. Oh, we're not supposed to have. Oh, Sister Beckman says she don't have no worries. You can have my worries. But I gave my worries to the Lord. Amen. And there's peace and joy and long-suffering.
Right.
And you just have to sing it like you believe it. And that's a trick. Like you believe it. Believe it like you believe it. He brought me out. Amen. I've been thinking about that lately. I've been thinking about all the reasons why people get saved. People get saved for a lot of different things, but one thing I got saved from was to get away from my past and all the sins I had. My heart was distressed, neath Jehovah's dread frown, and low in the pit where my sins dragged me down. I cried to the Lord from the deep miry clay, who tenderly brought me out to golden day. He brought me out of the miry clay. He set my feet on the rock to stay. He puts a song in my soul today, a song of praise, hallelujah. He placed me upon the strong rock by his side. My steps were established, and here I'll abide. No danger of falling while here I remain, but stand by his grace until the crown I gain. He brought me out of the miry clay. He set my feet on the rock to stay. He puts a song in my soul today, a song of praise, hallelujah. He gave me a song, 'twas a new song of praise. By day and by night, the sweet notes I will raise. My heart's overflowing, I'm happy and free. I'll praise my Redeemer who has rescued me. He brought me out of the miry clay. He set my feet on the rock to stay. He puts a song in my soul today, a song of praise, hallelujah. I'll sing of his wonderful mercy to me. I'll praise him till all men his goodness shall see. I'll sing of salvation at home and abroad, till many shall hear the truth and trust in God. He brought me out of the miry clay. He set my feet on the rock to stay. He puts a song in my soul today, a song of praise, hallelujah. I'll tell of the pit with its gloom and despair. I'll praise the dear Father who answered my prayer. I'll sing my new song, the glad story of love, then join in the chorus with the saints above. He brought me out of the miry clay. He set my feet on the rock to stay. He puts a song in my soul today, a song of praise, hallelujah. He brought me out of the miry clay. He set my feet on the rock to stay. He puts a song in my soul today, a song of praise, hallelujah. Amen. Amen. I'm grateful for that. Amen. Amen. Oh, I want to see him. Amen. Amen. As I journey through the land, singing as I go, pointing souls to Calvary, to the crimson flow. Many arrows pierce my soul from without within, but my Lord leads me on, through him I must win. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. Yes, on the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. When in service for my Lord, dark may be the night, but I'll cling more close to him, he will give me light. Satan's snares may vex my soul, turn my thoughts aside, but my Lord goes ahead, leads whate'er betide. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. Yes, on the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. My cares all past, I'm home at last, ever to rejoice. When in valleys low I look toward the mountain high, and behold my Savior there, he's leading in the fight. With a tender hand outstretched toward the valley low, guiding me I can see as I onward go. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face,
there to sing forever of his saving grace. Yes, on the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. My cares all past, I'm home at last, ever to rejoice. When before me billows rise from the mighty deep, then my Lord directs my bark, he does safely keep. And he leads me gently on through this world below. He's a real friend to me, oh, I love him so. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. Yes, on the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. My cares all past, I'm home at last, ever to rejoice. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. Yes, on the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. My cares all past, I'm home at last, ever to rejoice. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. I want to look on his face. Amen. Okay, so then everybody turn to the left. And now you can turn to the right. And I'm looking at him.
Amen, brother.
I see Jesus Christ in you.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. So you take up the prayer requests. Today, Sister Donna says she has an unspoken request. Sister Linda Helms says, please remember Jessica. Prayer for her and Davian. Also pray for Jeanette. She wants to be delivered. Amen.
Amen.
So I want to remember them. I want to remember the brothers and sisters in Israel. I want to remember the saints in Ukraine, in Haiti. Amen. There's a lot of places, Mexico, Central America, Africa. Just want to remember those that are afflicted with cancer. Bill Bailey, I want to remember Bob Koba, Elizabeth Murphy, Ron Spencer. The Lord will just touch them. And I'm sure that even this right now, you're thinking you have unspoken requests, some need, you'd like to see the Lord move in your life. Let's remember those also. Let's all stand together. Amen. Let's just join our voices. Amen.
Dear Lord Jesus,
Lord, Heavenly Father,
we're so thankful, Lord. We just want to see
you for the opportunity to be in your
presence. We just pray for you just come.
Lord, the opportunity to come and to hear
each and every one of
your prayers.
We pray, Father.
Lord Jesus, we just want to thank you in advance for worshiping you, to praise you.
Pray, Father, you will just touch me, Father, that you just
the Lord and ask the musicians go.
Pray, Lord Jesus.
Amen. And I'm going to ask Brother Marty if he'll just pray over the offering.
Amen. You may be seated. Amen. So we got a testimony from Brother Colin, his family. It says, "Dear friends, we are fine and well, and so is all of Israel." He says, except I believe one Muslim boy was injured. It is a complete and amazing miracle. There was barely any damage last night to Israel despite missiles sent that could destroy a region. Many countries helped shoot down missiles, including America and Jordan. I believe it was all the anointing of the Lord that so many missiles were successfully blocked. It is incredible what happened last night. Praise the Lord. Thank you so much for your prayers. Basically, last night could have looked completely different without his protection. We could have woken up and it looked like an apocalypse. But it looks nothing like happened at all. Amen. So, Brother Colin and his family. Amen. They thank you for your prayers. Amen. Sister Ann has a song for us this morning. Amen.
God bless you. There is a candle in every soul, some brightly burning, some dark and cold. There is a spirit who brings fire, ignites a candle and makes his home. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the hopeless, confused and torn, and hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle and go light your world. Take your candle and go light your world. Frustrated brother, see how he's tried to light his own candle some other way. See now your sister, she's been robbed and lied to, still holds a candle without a flame. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the lonely, the tired and worn, and hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle and go light your world. Take your candle and go light your world. We are a family whose hearts are blazing, so let's raise our candles and light up the sky. Praying to our Father in the name of Jesus, make us a beacon in darkest time. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the hopeless, deceived and poor. Hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle and go light your world. Take your candle and go light your world.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Great is his faithfulness. Amen. Amen. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine and 10,000 beside. Aren't you glad for that? Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy
hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Let's all stand together. Amen. Let's just sing that last verse. Amen. Amen.
Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thy own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow.
Amen.
Blessings all mine, men 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. Come on, Brother John. Amen. I'm so grateful that God is faithful. Amen. Amen. We fail, but he will not. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. It's good to have Brother Bruce back.
Amen.
Amen. It's good to see everybody. Amen. Praise the Lord. God is good.
Amen.
He's faithful when we're not faithful. I think the Bible says that if we are not faithful to him, he still remains faithful to us. God makes up the difference. That's what makes him one thing that makes him so great. And I think about everything that we do through the week that we could gather together with brothers and sisters of Light Precious Faith. And just have freedom and liberty in our heart to worship God and not to worry about what somebody, you know, at the store, we might wonder what somebody's going to look, you know, look at us like, what are you doing? But we can come here and have liberty.
Amen.
Because we're one family. Amen. God bless you this morning. Turn with me, if you would, to the book of Isaiah chapter 60. Isaiah chapter 60. Amen. How many has been praying for the service?
Amen.
How many has, since last service, if you were here or you live stream, how many was here or live streamed the last service? Okay, praise the Lord. Now, how many has tried to spend some extra time seeking the Lord since then? Okay, that is absolutely wonderful. Wonderful. I believe that is what we need to get where we want to get to.
Amen.
Whether it's in our church or in our private lives, the Lord is the answer.
Amen.
And for whatever reason it is, he just wants us to spend more time seeking him. And he deserves it because he's the creator. We are the creation. Amen. Let's look to the Lord in prayer before we read this here. Our Heavenly Father, once again, we want to thank you for the opportunity that you've given us to gather together. Lord, we're not just gathering in some place, but we're gathering in a place that's been dedicated for you, for your glory, for your honor, that you could be glorified, worshiped, praised, and that human lives could yield themselves to you, the great Holy Spirit, that you could move inside of us and reveal your word to us. Lord, we just thank you for this place where your word is honored. Lord, we ask now that you would come and anoint our eyes. We know thy word is already anointed. But Lord, come now and anoint our hearts. God, lift us up into a realm that we can have spiritual fellowship and communion with you, Lord. Lord, lift us above all the pressures and, Lord, all the worries and anxiety, the things that we've been facing through the week. Just lift us above that for, Lord, these few moments, and help us just to be wrapped up in your arms today, Lord. Bless us now as we invite your Spirit, Lord, to have the preeminence, for we pray these things in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Isaiah chapter 60, verse number 1 and 2. Arise, shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. Amen. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people. But the Lord shall rise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Well, I don't believe in coincidences, but we just had an eclipse. And some of us had the privilege of seeing it totally get dark. And just, the Bible says that darkness has covered the earth. Jesus said in the last days that there would be a turmoil, a nation would rise against nation. We see Israel and Iran rising up against Israel, Russia against Ukraine, China against Taiwan, North Korea is just threatening. Christians are being persecuted and displaced, read this morning, and killed in 28 of Africa's 54 countries. In Nigeria is one country that has seen a massive rise in attacks against who? The faithful. They say the faithful. The Bible says that Satan has weakened the nations. Once we were a great nation. And now literally we are the laughingstock of the world. Terrorism from within our own borders. Immorality and corruption is rampant. I believe the lid has been lifted off hell. And it's affected the earth. Darkness has covered the earth. Now it's a spiritual darkness. We see naturally what's happened, but it is a spiritual darkness. And the Bible says, we read this morning, that gross darkness, the people. Can we really trust anyone anymore? I remember a day that I was just young, and I made a $35,000 deal on a handshake. Well, I wouldn't think about doing that anymore. People are lying, they're manipulating, they're stealing, they're killing. Confusion about people's own identity. Not because God made a mistake, but because their own lustful flesh and Satan's ability to confuse, especially young people's minds. There's a massive decline in Christianity, and the Bible tells us that this is the day where the apostasy, the final apostasy has set in. Now, we know it already started in the first church age, but we're at the climax, and there's a great falling away. Evil spirits are getting inside of Christian homes and beginning to deteriorate and tear apart from the inside out. Selfishness and hatred, iniquity has become the new norm. Jesus said in Matthew 24 that many shall be offended and shall betray one another and shall hate one another. And many people shall be deceived. Gross darkness upon the people. And he said, because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. Amen. The church world is full of darkness as well. Can you say amen? Yes. It was just be honest. Jesus looked at the church in this age and said, it's lukewarm. Miserable people. He said they're miserable, spiritually blind, walking in darkness, and on top of it, they don't know it. They don't know their condition, their spiritual condition. In fact, they think they're doing so good that it's okay to come in church and just be entertained. Just, you know, this is what we want to feel like when we leave here. And they don't want the word anymore. We're told there's coming a time that people will not endure sound doctrine. They don't want anything that's going to challenge them, that's going to hurt them, that's going to make them have to give up something. Amen. They want a ministry to fit their appetite. You know, we're all going to go eat today, right? And if we go out to a restaurant, even if we go home, we're probably going to look for something that we want to eat. Nobody's going to like, let's cook this, I hate it. Nobody's going to do that. You're looking for something you want, right? And unfortunately, there's only one word. There's only one word. There is no choice. But people want to rip out part of it. We need to eat the whole word, right? That's the only way. It's hard to find a preacher who's willing to forsake money, popularity, reputation to preach the full truth. And I'll say it like this, with a balanced message, not just on one side. Gross darkness has covered the church. Paul told Timothy, this know also that in the last days perilous times shall come. Now this is what's happening in the church. For the men of the church shall be lovers of their own self. Covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, right in church. Disobedient to parents. Unthankful. Unholy. In a holy church, there's unholy people, unthankful people. Having a hard time to worship. Come on, it should be the easiest thing to do is to worship the Lord without natural affection, truth breakers, false accusers. You know, the devil's just looking for somebody he can use to accuse somebody. Incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good. Traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. So see, they're church people, they love God. But they have a love for other things. Amen. Having a form of godliness, as long as I got a form, as long as I go to church, as long as I do this, I should be okay. But Paul told him, he says, get away from them. Amen. Turn away. Right. Amen. Yes, sir. Because God has called us to be all His. Amen. You know, we got to make that decision. All in. I'm all in for God. Amen. Praise the Lord. On top of this gross darkness, God has also hid His word from the wise and the prudent. Think about this darkness in the church. They're blind, but then God has also hid it from the wise and prudent. It makes it difficult to hear from God. Do you believe that? Amen. Amos 8 verse 11 says, "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will send a famine in the land." Not a famine of bread. Not a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. Amen. And they shall wander from sea to sea, from the north even to the east, and they shall run to and fro and seek the Lord, seek the word of the Lord, and shall not find it. Amen. Look, the word is here. Amen. It has been given to us. But what we're missing is hearing it. Come on. Amen. The word is the word, but we're missing the hearing. People are struggling with hearing from God personally in their lives. They don't want to take the time to make it real. And coming to church and expecting God to just unfold everything that we want to unfold is not God's nature that He's just going to do that. That's why He's calling us to seek Him, yes, to spend time with Him. People don't want to take the time to wait on the Lord. They don't want to pay the price. And this is the gross darkness that's covered the church today. I don't want to be part of those that just are satisfied with not hearing the voice of God and coming to church and hearing the word preached. Hearing the word preached is not hearing the voice of God. Personally. What we have to do to hear the word of God personally is when the gospel is preached, that it hits here and says, I see the Lord in that. That is for me. God is speaking to me right there. This isn't just coming and fulfilling some obligation. But there's something happening now because I heard, and God said he had sent a famine. In other words, at one time, there was Azusa Street. At one time, you know, it just fell everywhere. But now you got to pay the price. You got to pay the price. 2 Timothy 3:13 says, but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But look at this. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned. Has been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. If we continue to press into the living word of God, then God will see you through. Amen. If you step away from the living word, it was, oh yeah, just another service again. Yeah, we're hearing the gospel. You know, Brother Johnny's saying the same old thing. You're not going to be protected. God is sending a living word. And it's got to be alive to us.
Amen.
Now, Satan is keeping people in spiritual darkness. There's chains. And it's through their unbelief. He's deceiving them. Revelation 12:9 says, and the great dragon was cast out, the old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world.
Amen.
He deceiveth the whole world. He was cast into the earth and his angels were cast out with him. Well, when he was cast out of heaven, he didn't stop deceiving. He's got his fingers in everything. And his goal is to deceive man from what? To keep man from giving their whole heart to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That is it.
Amen.
Because if they get serious about a relationship, he knows he's going to lose them.
Yes.
If I can just keep them religious, keep them distracted in the things of the world, let them think that family is more important than God, business is more important than God, hobbies are more important than God, that's deception.
Amen.
There's nothing more important than God.
Amen.
Satan is also called the accuser of the brethren. Anytime you go accusing somebody, you're walking in spiritual darkness and you don't even know it. Just the mere fact that you're accusing. Now, it's not whether the person that you're accusing is wrong. Wrong or right, it doesn't matter. What matters is don't accuse them. It's the accusing that makes you guilty. It doesn't matter how much they do wrong. You don't want that darkness on you. 2 Corinthians 4:3. There's a lot of scripture today, but I hope that's okay. The gospel is what helps me to know who Jesus Christ is. But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. In other words, our gospel is not hid to those that are saved. It's hid to them that are lost. In whom the God of this world, right? The God who's deceiveth the whole world, in whom the God of this world have blinded the minds of them which believe not. So it's real easy who he's blinding. He's blinding those who choose not to believe. the truth. That's how scary it is to come to church and really not believe the word. Because now you've just opened your door for blindness. It starts with our choice. Amen. Lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is in the image of God, should shine unto them. Unbelief keeps the light of God from opening up and helping us to see greater things. So, you know, if God shows us a scripture, let's just say this. God shows you the scripture that you need to be baptized the correct way. Okay, say you've been baptized, but it was incorrect, and God shows you the correct way to be baptized. Now, it's not good enough just to know it. That's a light. But you've got to walk in that.
Amen.
Now, once you walk in that light, what that does is now that just opens the door. Oh, that more light shines in your pathway so you can see more. But if you don't walk in the light that God speaks to your heart, because I'll say it like this, standing here is as surely as anything. This I know, God speaks to every person.
Amen.
There is no doubt and no question. Now, do we hear? Do we hear? Are we sensitive? Are we catching what he's saying? That's why we should come prepared. That's why we should come more prepared and not just show up to church. Show up the right way. Imagine for a moment that tomorrow you're literally going to die and you're going to meet God. Are you just going to go home and just show up? No, you're literally going to go home and you're going to think about that you're going to meet your Maker.
Amen.
And you will begin to think about, is there anything that needs to be taken care of? Because it now becomes the most important thing. But look, if we really believe God is here, and God is, we're going to have a meeting with God, God's going to speak to us, we're going to do the same thing.
Amen.
We're going to prepare. We're going to say, Lord, I don't want to miss what you have for me, because it is too easy to come to church and just kind of like we're laid back and just, you know, listen to the word being preached. But, you know, it's not just the word being preached, the enjoyment or whatever our natural man can get out of it. But, you know, it's a fearful thing to fall in the hands of a living God. And I'm sure God has something for me that he wants me to do. Have I done all that he's asked me to do? Or have I brushed something out of the rug? Have I forgot about it? Have other things become more important to me? Just things begin to slip. We don't want that. I believe that we are a chosen people here.
Amen.
We're a little different than anybody else. Jesus said, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you.
Amen.
And I ordained you. He chose us above all other people on the earth, the Bible says. And he did it because he loved us. And, you know, I just can't wrap my hand around that. I don't know if I'll ever comprehend that. We've been predestinated to be just like Jesus. And Jesus gave us a commandment that we're to love one another just like he loved us, which is, I can't comprehend how much he loves me. I still fail him every day and he's loving me. And then he gives me this big commandment that I don't know if I can fulfill these shoes. That I actually got to love you the way that he loved me.
Right.
And not just you, but out there in the world.
Right.
Because you know the love of God is without respect to persons.
Amen.
He loves those out there just like he loves me. But not only did he give us a commandment to love us, to love one another like he loved us, he said, I want you to be perfect. Jesus said, I want you to be perfect like my Father in heaven is perfect.
Amen.
I want you to love your enemies now. Well, you know, that takes work.
Yeah.
You know what kind of work that takes? That takes you dying out so much the only thing you want to do is please God. That's the work, is getting yourself out of the way so God could come inside and actually do the job. He's the only one that can do it. His love is the greatest love on the planet. It endures all things, right? It believes all things. It doesn't vaunteth itself. There's nothing about it about itself. It lives for others. Now, the Bible calls us a special people. Calls us precious. We're the apple of God's eye. We are His bride. 1 Peter 2, verse 9 says that we are a chosen generation, if you want to write that down. We are different. We're a chosen generation. He chose us. A royal priesthood. A holy nation. A peculiar people. A holy nation. Now, we're not talking about the USA. We're not talking about that nation. We're talking about individuals. His chosen. They are a holy nation. Be ye holy even as I am holy. Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. Holiness is a part of God's special people. Now, we are 100% different than the people that are in the world. Come on, you're going to help me? We don't want to have a three-hour service here. We are 100% different than the people in the world. Now, we're flesh and blood. And everybody will have a chance to hear the gospel. But what makes us different is we believe the gospel. We believe what God said. That's what makes us different. And it's not a mental belief. It's not some religion. It's not some covering. It's something inside of us bears witness with this word that it is 100% true, not just for everybody, but it's 100% true for me. That if my brother or my sister choose not to live by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God, I have made my choice. I will live by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Well, what about them? That's not between me and them. That's between them and their creator. But the bride is 100% different than the world. While every nation on earth is decaying morally, we have been called to be a holy nation. We are part of a group that goes around the world. Now, part of this nation has already gone on to the reward. Amen? But there is still a living bride here, and they're going to be caught up. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, there's going to be a rapture. And there's going to be a few here and a few there all over the world. They make up a holy nation. Now, we're strange. We're strange. The Bible says we're pilgrims and strangers. But you know, we're really strange to people. Brother Dennis is always telling us little testimonies that always bringing out the facts how different he is than the people of the world. Amen?
Amen.
We're supposed to be. We're odd.
Amen.
We're unique. We're unusual. We're different. We're distinct. But we're set apart just for God. And what makes us different is that people do not love God the way we do.
Amen.
The bride of Christ is a peculiar people. A chosen generation to show forth the praises of Him who called us out of darkness into His marvelous light.
Amen.
Now, to me, coming to church and not worshiping, that's the norm. That's the worldly way. But for us, we've been chosen to show forth the praises of him that called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. This is the hour to praise him. Well, I don't want you to feel bad, maybe, that you didn't praise him the way that you should have when Brother Bruce gave you opportunity. I don't want you to do that. But what I want you to do is start praising him right now.
Amen.
Give glory to his word. Let him know you're uniting with the word and you're thankful for the word. You know, a lot of people say, well, you know, I'm thankful. But they don't show it.
Yeah.
Or, I love you, but they don't show it. What good is having anything if it's not shown?
Right?
All the people that have gone by the way of the grave and they're not here today have no opportunity to show anything. It's just a memory. But we have an opportunity to manifest love. Manifest, I praise you, Lord. And there's so many ways to do it. But if you read the Bible in the book of Psalms and in the New Testament, you will find that praise, yes, it does originate from the heart, but it's not supposed to be just there in the heart. It needs to come through the body, through the lips, through the hands.
Amen.
It's a sacrifice of praise. And the thing is, the world knows how to praise. Just go to any sports game or so many different things out there. I mean, I was at Applebee's yesterday, and, you know, they got the old TVs up there, and they're just, like, playing golf, and, you know, they hit it, and everybody there's watching is going, good job, good job. They're giving praise to that person that shot a good shot. You know, God blessed us today with mercies.
Amen.
New mercies. That's a great shot.
Yes.
No man can shoot like that.
Amen.
No God can shoot like he can shoot. No one can forgive like he can forgive. And I'll tell you, there ought to be so many reasons that I can't wait to get to church. I'm going to praise him. I'm going to worship him like I've never done it before. You know, today, I am more debt today to God than I was 20 years ago. 20 years ago, I had sinned less. I've sinned more in the last 20 years. I haven't been perfect. I praised him back there 20 years ago. I ought to be praising him more now today. He's revealed more of his word to me. I've got more light to walk. I got a lot of reasons to praise him. He gave me breath today. He put a desire in my heart to put him first above all the things of this world. He's worthy to be praised. I got to get back to my message. God has called his people out of gross darkness. He's called. Have you heard his call?
Amen.
Now, if you want to know the very nature of the Holy Spirit, is to lead and guide you into all truth.
Yes.
He is not satisfied that you're in a message church. Job said, I'll not be satisfied till I wake in his likeness. John said, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. The very nature of the Holy Ghost is when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will lead and guide you into all truth.
Amen.
Now we, in this flesh, are always wanting to just stop wherever we're at. Like I'm paying my tithes now. I wasn't doing that for 20 years. I'm paying it now. And you know what? That should be good enough. It should be in our carnal mind, but in the mind of God, he wants to see us in his image, with his character. So that means he wants us to walk in more light. So when I asked the question, have you heard his call yet? What was the last thing that God asked you to do? What was the last thing? Because that, whatever he asked you to do, whatever he asked you not to do anymore, that was light.
Amen.
That was light that he's saying here. See this? I want you to walk in this. And look, our flesh just wants to go to a church and hear somebody say, you're bride, you're there, you're in.
Yep. Right.
Don't change.
Amen.
And that is what they say is encouraging. I'm just speaking of the world now, not speaking the message. Look, I'm so glad God has a vision for me greater than where I'm at today. I'm glad that my God thinks more of me than what I am today, because I know I'm not there yet. I don't want to be satisfied with this. What is this? All you got to do is take 5 minutes and look at the things you're thinking about, the things you're desiring, and where you're going. The bride is different than the church. It's different than the foolish virgin. It's different than waiting 1,000 years and hoping you make it through judgment. The bride has been chosen. She's chosen to follow the whole word.
Amen.
2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. Notice, before God ever saved us, we had to do something. We had to make a decision to separate ourselves from the world. We had to say, okay, I'm not going to live the way I want to live anymore. And I had to separate myself before God would receive me. And he says in verse 18, and will be a father unto you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty.
Amen.
Today, God is still separating.
Amen.
He's still calling for a separation.
Yeah.
Can we identify? Now, look, I'm just going to be honest with you. Every one of us is very good at identifying, and sorry for moving around so much. We are very good at identifying of what other people need to separate from.
Right?
We didn't even go to college for that. And we don't even go to, a place to learn that. But, we have a hard time recognizing what we are being called by God to separate from. Now remember, if God was through with you now, I believe as long as we got breath, we ought to be pressing towards that mark.
Amen.
And I mean pressing. Not just, on a skateboard and somebody has to push us. That we actually got to do the work. Press in. All right, 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father's not in him. Boy, that's pretty cut and dry there, isn't it?
Amen.
For all that is in the world, now we're not talking about earth. We're talking about worldly nature here. Is the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, is not of the Father, It's of the world. So he said that there so we could see if that we're desiring something that isn't God to recognize that's not of God.
Right.
No matter what it is,
amen.
If God's not in it, stay away from it.
Amen.
It'll bring damage. Amen. And the world passeth away and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever.
Amen.
Ever. 2 Timothy 2:4, no man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who has chosen him to be a soldier.
Amen.
A soldier of what? The gospel, of the light that he has brought to us. Now when Jesus said, he taught us there, and I believe... I know he taught us this. I was just trying to figure out which book it was in. But it's in the book of the Bible. That's where he taught us. And he said, he told us to go out and baptize all and to teach them all things whatsoever I command you.
Amen.
So now, he give us light. We've got to help somebody in the same light he's given us. Now, we can't force it. We can't push it. We can't make them, but we can teach it.
Amen.
We can teach them to observe the same light that God showed us. Because, you know, God's no respecter of persons. God doesn't want me walking in more light than you, and God doesn't want you walking in more light than me. His desire is that we all walk in all the light.
Amen.
All the light. What's different between me and you? It's our callings, and it's the time that God reveals himself to us. I can't give you revelation. You can't give me revelation. But we can pray together that God gives us revelation. Now, God has given us a marvelous light. We ought to be the most grateful people on the planet. Look, we're all born in homes. We had family members, and not all of them are walking in the light. We know people that had the same opportunity, sat in the same church. They're not even here now.
Right.
That right there, that thought process ought to make us so grateful for the light. We ought to be the most happiest, grateful people on the planet. It should be easy for us to come into church and just worship freely. Now, God didn't just give us a little bit of light, but God gave us a marvelous light.
Amen.
A marvelous light. Now, before I knew about this light, I went to church. In fact, I went to a number of churches before I came into the truth of this glorious light. And we read the Bible in the churches I went to. In fact, I read the Bible at home. And although I could tell you the words that I was reading, I really couldn't tell you what it meant, what it really, really meant. Now, you would think for me going to church, me reading the Bible, that I had light. But just because I go to church and I read the Bible doesn't mean I have the light.
Amen.
Are you with me? Unless God speaks to our hearts and he opens our eyes to what the word says, we're still in spiritual darkness. So that's why I never want you to get comfortable with just being in church and saying, okay, we did our duty for the day. No, I want to hear his voice. I want to make sure I'm connected. I want to make sure that it's opening to me. Matthew chapter 13, verse 10. Please read, follow along with us on this. And the disciples came and said unto Jesus, why speak thou unto these people in parables? And he answered and said unto them, because it is given unto you, to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. But unto these other people, it is not given. Now here's a God that's saying, look, I want some people to know the truth and some people not. Now why would he say that? Because they don't love him. Now look, the real answer to hearing from God is fall more in love with Him. Fall in love with Him. Make it real. It's not about doing things for the church. It's not about giving more money. It's about love. I love the Word. Now, how do you know you love God? Is when you love the Word. Amen. You can't love God and not love His Word. Even Jesus said, you call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things I say. If you love me, keep my commandments. There's a love affair there. Verse 12, for whosoever hath, to him it shall be given, and he shall have more abundance. But whosoever hath not, from him shall be taken away, even that which he hath. Now, what does that mean? It's like he's talking in parables to his own disciples. Let me just throw a word in there for a second. For whosoever hath the love of God, to him shall it be. The word be given. And he shall have more abundance. Amen. But whosoever hath not the love of God, from him shall be taken away, even that which he already has. Amen. Therefore speak I to them in parables, because they seen, they don't see. And hearing, they don't hear. Neither do they understand. Amen. And in them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah, which saith, by hearing you shall hear and shall not understand, and seeing you shall see and shall not perceive. For this people's heart is waxed gross, their ears are dull of hearing, their eyes have been closed. They just like sit in church and they go, yeah, whatever. Lest at any time they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and should understand with their hearts and should be converted, and I should heal them. Amen. You know, it takes the word, the believing of the word, to bring forth a conversion. You can't just say, I go to church, I'm born again, I believe the message. That doesn't do it. The word has to become open to you. When I say the word, I don't mean you got to know from cover to cover. That is not what I'm saying. What I am saying is when God speaks to you something in this word, you've got to start doing it. Because by you following the word that he tells you to do, what you're doing is you're opening your character, your nature to become completely born again. Completely converted. If you notice, there are people who go to church, but they go out there and they live like the world. God is looking for a full conversion. Now, I'm not saying it didn't start right, but you know what? We got to finish this race. It's not he that starts the race. We got to finish the race. And what it takes to finish the race is the same thing that took to start it. Your heart, your love. Amen. Now look what he says here about us. But blessed are your eyes, for they see. There's light that's coming to you that you see, and your ears, for they hear. I'm thankful for the eyes that God has given me, the ears that God has given me. Now, I'm not saying that you're going to walk out of here completely different. And if you don't, you know, something was wrong. No. No, this message goes out and it just covers. The thing is, if you're willing to start putting forth more effort to walk in the things that God has shown you, God is going to bless you. Amen. But look, the spirit of this age, this lukewarmness, it's not hot, it's not cold. It ain't where you just stay home all day, and it ain't where you're just, you know, you leave here and you never go home and you're on the mission field. It's lukewarm. It's a knowledge of the truth, but it's an unwillingness to put it into practice. Praise the Lord. That's exactly what it is. It's a form. But I want the life. I want the life. For verily I say unto you that many prophets and many righteous men have desired to see the things that you see today and have not seen them, and to hear the things which you hear and have not heard them. Right. I go back to all the churches that I used to go to before I came into this message. And I'll tell you, to think about that, they don't have what we have today. You have been blessed. Somehow God has chosen you above everybody, of all the people on the planet, to give you this truth. And I say, as Jesus said, blessed are your eyes, they see. Blessed are your ears, for they hear. We ought to be so happy what God has done for us in our lives. I'll tell you, Brother Branham says, it'll make a Methodist shout. It'll make us get out of our seats and just be so thankful for the Lord. We get so comfortable. We just want, when's the service over? He's getting kind of excited today. Wish you'd just stay by in the pulpit and just, to be honest with you, I wish I stayed by in the pulpit too. Actually, God knows, I all I can say is I don't want to face the Lord not preaching. Other than that, if he wasn't involved, I certainly would never be here. God has given us eyes to see. God has sent a Bible prophet in this generation. Amen. That's why we're a chosen generation. A chosen generation. Most people don't know, but Amos 3:7 says, surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he revealeth his secrets unto his servants, the prophets. So people that think they don't need to go to church, they don't need a prophet to make it, are so deceived. Because it is the way that God chose. And we've got to follow God's pattern. Malachi chapter 4, verse 5. Behold, I send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. There's not a week that goes by that I'm not dealing with somebody that's talking about the end time, that we're at the end. And when you look at some of these people, there's a dread on their face. It's like, I don't want the end to be here. There's just more stuff that I want to do. I want to see things. We are approaching the great and dreadful day of the Lord. It's about us. It's going to happen. But praise God that he sent us a marvelous light when he sent us Elijah 4:5 in the office of a prophet. Now, he was just a man like you and I. But he held an office that was higher than ours. And God, forgive me, I don't want to do this. I don't want to stand on that place where we give our heart. But he could stand up a little bit higher and see from God things that we could not see. Amen. And then he came down here and he started giving it to the people. Now, I was never fortunate enough to be in one of his meetings, Brother Dennis. But you know what? God preserved the word. Amen. And he sent somebody by my way to tell me about this message. Amen. And when I read it, something clicked on the inside. I can't explain it, but there was a connection there. I felt like I was a part of this, that I was chosen for this. And it was a greater light than I'd ever seen in all the churches I was in. I'll say it's a marvelous light that God has chosen us to be a part of. And you know what the purpose of this message or what Brother Branham was supposed to do? He was to get us turned completely to the Lord. That's it. Not another church, not another religion, but completely to him. To love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy might. Amen. Give him your everything. That the word of God is never changed. And that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He turned us to the truth. He returned us back. And you know, if it wasn't needed, God would have never sent them. But it was needed. It was needed. Matthew chapter 17, verse 9. Are you with me? Matthew 17, verse 9. After Jesus was transfigured before his disciples, they came down from the mountain and Jesus charged them. He said, tell the vision to no man until the Son of Man be risen again from the dead. And all of a sudden that just sparked something inside of them and said, whoa, wait a minute. The disciples asked him, saying, why then say the scribes that Elias must first come? Before this all happens, why do the disciples say, that Elias must first come? They had this question, they wanted it answered, and Jesus answered and said unto them, Elias truly shall first come and restore all things. Now, because of Malachi 4:6, which is a due prophecy, Jesus is talking about two comings of Elijah, because God uses the coming of Elijah five times. And I know this can get kind of deep for some of us that don't know these things, but just try to take the words that are spoken here, okay? He's saying, why say the scribes that Elias must first come? And Jesus answered, Elias shall truly first come and restore all things. So Jesus is talking about something in the future. Amen. The spirit of Elijah will bring a marvelous light, because it takes a marvelous light to restore all things, does it not? Amen. But this could not have been the prophet John the Baptist. John the Baptist did not restore all things. The Bible says that John did no miracles. He was just the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord's first coming. At this time, this is Matthew 17. In Matthew chapter 4, John the Baptist was in prison. And they did, well, let's just read this. Why then say the scribes that Elias must first come? Jesus is referring to a future tense. So it's not about John the Baptist. But then he goes right back to what they were talking about in verse 12. But I say unto you that Elias is come already. Past tense. And they have done, and they knew him not. See, that's why they were asking, why say the scribes that Elias must first come? They didn't recognize it, and they knew him not, but have done unto him whatsoever they listed, likewise shall also the Son of Man suffer of them. And the disciples understood that he spake unto them of John the Baptist. So here Jesus in his ministry, he's referring now to Elijah's ministry that's going to come in our age. He was taking us back to the Word. He was taking us back to Malachi 4. Jesus said, search the Scriptures, and God will always take you back to the Word. Always. Now, after Jesus died, he resurrected, and he went back into heaven. In Acts chapter 3, verse 21, the Bible says that the heavens must receive Jesus until the times of restitution of all things, which God hath spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. Amen. So this is just spoken by one man, by all the holy prophets since the world began. It wasn't time for restoration yet, but God promised in this age, I will restore, saith the Lord. All that Satan had deteriorated, God was going to restore it back to the church. Revelations 10:7, we're talking about the marvelous light in our age. But in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, this is the seventh church age messenger now, right. When he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God should be finished, as he have declared to his servants, the prophets. Right. That means this message is going to clear up every question you're going to have.
Amen.
If you're wondering about something, the answer is in that message. There's no doubt about it. It's a glorious light, a marvelous light. And, you know, time has slipped away to where I can't even get to where all I want to get to. So we're going to be skipping some stuff. Turn with me to 1 John chapter 1. This glorious message was sent to us. And God wants us to walk in this truth. 1 John chapter 1, verse 5. This then is the message which we have heard of him, and now we're declaring it unto you, that God is light. And in him is no darkness at all. Not even a little bit. None. Now, the problem is, we all got darkness. But who cares enough about that darkness? Who cares enough to start getting it out? Because what we need to do is arise. Our light has come. We need to arise out of our darkness. Amen?
Right. Amen.
If we say that we have fellowship with God and walk in darkness, we actually lie and we do not the truth.
Amen.
But if we walk in the light that God has shown us, as he is in the light, that's what that means, we have fellowship one with another, and then the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sins. My, how happy we ought to be. If we say that we have no sin, I don't need to come to the altar. I don't need to pray. I don't need to seek the Lord. I don't need to say sorry. I don't need to. We deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Praise the Lord. Such a simple thing we got to do. You don't have to worry about doing cartwheels, backflips, stand on your head, hold your breath for 3 minutes. Just be honest with God. In order to just confess your sin, it takes love. Because it's not our nature to want to say, yeah, it was wrong. In fact, if I do something wrong to Jonathan, my flesh would probably say, well, the only reason I did it is because blah, 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 blah. Right? That's what my flesh wants to say. So you go against nature, but if I love God, and I know it displeases God to have something between me and Jonathan, I'm just going to confess it. I confess. I'm just getting it out there. And then I can approach God with boldness. God, I am sorry. Cover me with your blood.
Amen.
Cover me with the blood from Calvary. And it's that simple. That's what a love affair is with God. It's not nothing special where you know all the Bible. It's living what you do know. Praise the Lord. Matthew chapter 5, verse 14. And is this been good enough to where I can hold you just a couple minutes? Okay, because we had a special, and we had extra things going on. They got started late. All right, Matthew chapter 5, verse 14. Jesus speaking to us, he said, "You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid." How many has, you know, gone over maybe like in that hill there in Cincinnati? And that, at night, you come over that hill, and it just opens up, and all the lights are on. Oh, we've seen pictures at night. We've been in a plane at night. You're coming down. You see the city. If all the lights are off, you can't see. But when the lights are on, you can see. And here Jesus is saying to us, a city that's set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, that it giveth light into all that are in the house. The gospel is not something to be hid from others.
Amen.
Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven.
Amen.
Now, I know if there were some people, they would have probably wrote the word like this. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify you on earth. But God deserves all the glory.
Amen.
If you've got any light inside of you, that is the grace of God.
Amen.
Why would you want to steal glory from God? Now that word shine, when Jesus said, let your light so shine, shine means to give light. Not to say, I've got light. To give it. It means to beam it.
Amen.
In other words, you got your low beams in the car and your high beams. You beam it. It means with radiant brilliancy. God wants to see all of us beaming the light. Beam it. Not just beam it to people that don't know the Lord, but beam it to me. Paul told Timothy to be an example unto the believer. Beam it one to another. I need you. You need one another. I was going to say you need me, but I'm not going to say that. We need one another.
Amen.
We need one another.
Amen.
We need to beam and help one another.
Amen.
And, you know, part of that light is love. Part of it is forgiveness.
Yes.
Part of it is I unconditionally accept you without respect to persons.
Yep.
Part of it is giving a helping hand. Part of it is when somebody knocks on the door and says something, you're there.
Yeah.
But you've got light, beam it. Now, it's hard to beam the light if you're filled with self, selfishness, strife, anger, hatred, wrath, anxiety. It's hard to shine the light if you're filled with darkness. All right, 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Now, believe me, I'm going to bypass a lot of this, but we got some good word here in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6, about this light that God wants us to shine. For God who commanded the light to shine, now notice it's a commandment, to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this light or this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. Now look, this is how you shine it. We're troubled on every side, but we're not distressed. We're perplexed about what's going on, but we're not in despair. We're persecuted all around. We're getting persecuted, but we're not forsaken. God's still with us. We're cast down. People cast us down, but we're not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body, our body, the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. For we which live are always delivered unto the death of Jesus' sake, for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. So then death worketh in us, but life in you. I say today, it's time for us to arise out of the darkness that we're in. Now remember, if we say we have no darkness, we lie. Think about what God has been speaking to you. Just take a look at your life. What are some of the things that you know has not been pleasing? It's time to rise out of ourselves, out of the darkness, out of the flesh, the selfishness, or out of our will, out of our anger, our strife, our hopelessness, our anxiety, our getting upset. It's time for us to rise out of that because the light of God has come to our hearts. Now we got to take the step and it's arise and get move away from that.
Amen.
You can't wait for your circumstances to be better before you choose to walk in the light. That's not love. That's not love. That means, you know, take all the demons away, take all my temptations away, surround me with such loving people, and I'll be a good Christian. No. Put me in the worst condition and let me shine for Jesus. Put me in the greatest temptation, let me shine for Jesus. It's time to arise. To rise. Oh, rise. Like we're sitting down, eventually we're going to rise up, right? You're probably hoping, Brother John, I wish we would arise. I've been sitting here a while. Just write this down. Romans chapter 13, verse 11 through 14. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. It's time to cast off the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Colossians 3, verse 8 through 15. We're supposed to put off anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of our mouth. Lie not one to another, seeing you put off the old man. Take those things off and put on as the elect of God, bowels of mercy. You know, hatred is of the devil.
Amen.
Put it off. That's a work of darkness. The spirit of hatred literally binds people from seeing straight. And if you read this, 1 John chapter 2, verses 8 through 11. If you say that you're walking in the light, you hate somebody, you're lying, you're deceived, you're blind, and you don't even know it. That's why I want you to read that. Oh my. It's time to arise, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. Can you say that the light of God has shined on me? He just wants us to rise and start walking in it. Start walking in that light. Our light is come. It's time to live for God. It's time to win souls. It's time to be about the Father's business. Amen. It's time to put away childish behavior. Childish behavior is, I don't like what they did to me. Can you say amen? It's time to put that away. It's obvious we don't like what they did to us. But you know what? That just opened the door for me to beam a light.
Yes.
To love the unlovable. To give. To let people use you. Amen.
Right.
Hey, pray for them.
Yes.
You know, not only people are going to use you, they're going to despitefully use you. It's okay. It's okay. That's between them and God. God never said if things were going to be easy. He just told us to arise and let our light shine. And we all, I just want to be a billion watt beamer. I want to have so much light that I don't have to worry about making the wrong move. Right? Just give what you have for the service of the Lord.
Amen.
God's calling you to do anything. Just do it.
Amen.
Do it. Because I'll say like this. You know, we're done here. We're not going to hold you any longer. But listen to this. God is hidden simplicity.
Amen.
If we're looking for something that we agree with, we're probably going to miss God. Because we wouldn't need the Holy Ghost then, see? Yeah, the Holy Ghost is here to show us what he wants us to start doing. And it's in every one of our grips. We can walk out of here and beam the light, think about, Lord, what would you have me to do? Lord, what darkness would you have me to get out of? How would you what do you want me to rise to that I haven't been doing? Because it's our opportunity, and it shows that we love God. Let's stand together. The light isn't meant to be kept under the bushel of yourself, right? The bushel of your life, your home, your wants, your desires. It's time to shine. It's time to shine. Amen. Let's sing, We Are the Generation. Amen. We are the generation. Praise the Lord. We are the generation. We're the culmination, the final voice the world will hear. The coming of the Lord is near. Lean out the revelation, overcoming sin's temptation. The truth will go to every tongue and nation. We are the chosen generation. Sing it with me. We are the generation. We're the culmination, the final voice the world will hear. The coming of the Lord is near. Living out the revelation, overcoming sin. The truth will go to every tongue and nation. We are the chosen generation. Amen. It's a high calling. We are the generation. We're the culmination, the final voice the world will hear. The coming chosen generation. How many believes that you are part of the chosen generation? Amen. What a privilege it is. Let's sing Shine, Jesus Shine. Huh? What? I didn't tell you that one? Yeah, I just want you to know. I'm guilty. But I also want you to know, I'm guilty of a lot more. I want you to get a right perspective of me. Can we do that one? That's okay. That's okay. That's okay. We got the flute. Back up. Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness, shining. Light of the world, shine upon us, set us free from the truth you now bring us. Shine on me, shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Lord, I come to your awesome presence, from the shadows into your radiance. By the blood I may enter your brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me, shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the fire. our faces display your likeness, ever changing from glory to glory. Near here may our lives tell your story. Shine on me. Good. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood the nations with voice and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Amen. You know, as much as that was like maybe not such a, like one we'd want to have when we invite our friends to the church, you know, that type of song, I do believe the Lord saw our hearts to want to be what that song was saying.
Amen.
I felt that spirit as we were singing it. And that's what's important. I want to go before the Lord in prayer today. And maybe there would be someone that would just say, Brother John, I want to start walking in more light than I've been walking. And you want to be remembered in prayer. Amen. God bless your hands. God sees this beautiful desire. I don't know another desire than to please the Lord that would be as important as that. Amen. Heavenly Father, we come to you thanking you, Lord, that you have brought your light to us. When we were in darkness and didn't care about anything but ourselves, Lord, you sent somebody by our way to let us know that you were calling us, that you had a word that you wanted to give us, that without you, we could not make it, and that you loved us in our situation, that even though we weren't perfect, that we weren't even caring about you, you still had a love for us like we've never seen before. God, because of that love, you stayed there even. Lord, just looking back on my own self, I remember the times just rejecting you, rejecting that call, but you kept calling. You didn't give up. Lord, by your grace, we don't want to ever give up. But Lord, we want to continue to shine more light than we've ever shined before. You saw our hands, you saw our hearts, our desire to be a greater light for you, Lord, because you're worthy. You're worthy of the light that you brought us into. Lord, we just feel in our heart this indebtedness to go share this light with other people, that they may too know you the way that we know you, to experience your love the way that we experience it. To have this joy in our heart, to have this peace that passeth all understanding, to have this willingness to be long-suffering and forbearing and to be gentle with others. And Lord, it's our yearning and our desire to be that for others. God, may you give us more of the Holy Ghost. That's the true light of your word is the living word of God, the Holy Ghost. I pray that you would fill every one of us, Lord, every one that just raised their hand and said, God, I want to walk in this light. Give them, Lord, that power within the inside of themselves to just knock over any bushel, to put that low beam on high beam, and just to be a radiant vessel for your kingdom and for your honor, Lord. We commit all of our lives into your hands. We commit this purpose that we have. Now, Lord, may you add to it. May you multiply it. May you bless it. Bless our lives, Lord, that when you return, that you'll be pleased. We'll give you all the praise for it. We do now in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.